let it not be said that nothing good came out of 2020. For Tucker, of all the things he could list, the two most prominent would be 1. His lady, and 2. This album. You see, his feelings for these two do not exist apart from one another, but not in a weird way.
For example, it's not like I want to marry the album.
Well, that's progress. In fact, when Tucker listens to the album, he can't help but be reminded of his lady. That means, for those of you keeping track at home, he finds it relatable. These aforementioned feelings, combined with Tucker's compulsion to express himself through video, have now driven him to write this monologue, set up this equipment, and ready his bowels in preparation to discuss his feelings at length in this meta-review format. Without further ado, here's Tucker as he discusses the album.
Jump Rope Gazers is the sophomore album by the Beths, a band from New Zealand fronted by Elizabeth Stokes. Their debut album, Future Me Hates Me, is also quite good, but for the sake of focus, I will not be comparing the two, at least not much. One of the songs from Jump Rope Gazers was recommended to me through a daily mix on Spotify last summer. I love it. Sound-wise, it's right up my alley. I guess you'd call it indie pop rock shoegaze. But you didn't hear that from me because I don't know genres. It has energy when it needs to, and it's softer and more acoustic when it needs to be, which I guess is one contrast from their previous work. I read in an interview where Liz was saying how they were taking a chance with the more quiet and vulnerable songs because they hadn't really done many like that previously. I applaud that effort because I think they're good at those songs and they help make this album what it is. To me, almost every song reminds me of my fiancé Sarah in some way or another, but I'll get into that more later. And I suppose the subject matter is timely if I get this done on Valentine's Day. Anywho, on to the songs. I'm Not Getting Excited is about that pessimistic voice in your head that makes you doubt good things in your life and keeps your expectations low. As far as the sound goes, it absolutely rocks. It's a real banger, as the kids say. It reminds me of the first few months knowing Sarah, when we had a good friendship, but I didn't have the confidence to tell her I liked her. I didn't want to have the expectation that it would develop into anything more in case it didn't. Because at the time, our friendship itself was such a precious thing that I didn't want to risk losing. Dying to Believe portrays a hurtful conversation with possibly a toxic friend, and how just putting up with someone treating you like that can affect your self-esteem. I haven't gone through extreme cases of this, but I know people who have. Of course, those situations are ongoing and have potential for healing. The song, though, has some of the tightest lyrics on the album. And this one in particular is from the chorus. Go easy, you know it isn't worth the fight, and you're losing every match you set alight. It burns me, but I'll smile through the heat. I'm dying to believe that you won't be the death of me. How it transitions from a fighting match to a burning match is very well done. And the song also, just simply put, rocks. Jump Rope Gazers reminds me of Sarah and I right out of the gate. We're in a long-distance relationship, and when I was first writing notes for this several months ago, there was a week when we almost didn't get to see each other's faces over video chat because of busyness and whatnot. So the lyric, I've never been the dramatic type, but if I don't see your face tonight, I guess I'll be fine. Begins like you start to get upset, but then your love for the person softens you and you show the situation some grace. I guess I'll be fine. There's also a lot of parallel feelings I can draw back on from my own budding relationship experience. You know, when things start clicking and it starts becoming obvious to everyone that,
you know, perhaps there's something there that wasn't there before.
And then the lyric, I think I love you. And I think I loved you the whole time. And there's still an element of it not being perfect, though. And I think that helps keep the song grounded for me. The bridge is interesting to interpret. I remember watching the waves rolling in, numbered in the thousands, collect, break up again. I was just waiting for the grazes on my hands to mend. I was afraid of the sting. It could be a literal memory recounting, but taken as a metaphor, the waves could be incoming feelings and potential for the new relationship, while grazes on the vocalist's hand could be hurt carried over from past relationships that keep her from wading into the new one because salt water is painful on open wounds. I'm not sure how much I could speculate on what jump rope gazers the phrase means, and I think it's intentionally left up to interpretation. It just kind of makes sense and has a ring to it. Acrid. I love the phrase meticulous nonchalance, used by Liz Stokes when describing the song, about when you want to get to know someone, but you don't want to be too obvious about it. But then it just turns into an unspoken obviousness because there's just no way the amount of interest you're showing could be for casual reasons. I'm definitely not speaking from personal experience. That being said, I don't want to impose my own experiences on every one of these songs, and it may be pushing it to say I relate to even most of the elements in this song. Though most of the songs on this album are about long-distance relationships, which has mainly been my experience as well. So that being the case, I've never tried to physically run into anybody. Wait, now that I think about it, that may not be true. Yeah, I did do that once. And I did hear back later that it was indeed obvious. I also relate to the third verse about sending meticulously crafted late night messages that are probably too vulnerable, and then it feels like it takes an eternity for the recipient to reply. Thankfully, for me, it seems to be working out. Do you want me now? Oof. This one hits home, and for context, we'll need to go back a ways before Sarah and I were engaged. We met in person, and I had liked her almost immediately, but I held back, and we just grew a nice friendship for a few months. I learned later that she had liked me too. So in a way we had been playing our own game of two-sided meticulous nonchalance before I was compelled to share my feelings. She said she had feelings for me too, but needed time. What followed was the longest month and a half of my life. I had no idea where we were at, and it took me to some of the darkest places I've been in recent memory. That is more or less the situation that this song laments over. In our case, I gave Sarah space and she did come around. Now, even though we are going strong, this song still makes me sad, and I love it for that. Long distance is the wrong distance. Out of sight strikes a different chord about a relationship that has some miles on it and staying committed through troubled times. Looking at the first verse, it must be the most cryptic on the album, and I'm not sure where I would begin interpreting it. The second verse is clearer. The line, "You hold a lot and I know I'm kind of a bummer," hits me. "You hold a lot" is probably talking about self-isolation and holding back feelings. And then self-diagnosing yourself as a bummer probably means depression. I know I can worry about how that affects my significant other and not wanting it to rub off on them. Also, wanting them to be happy and not fall into the shadow of my cloud. That worry can be amplified by a long distance. I like the lyric, "If your world collapses, I'll be down in the rubble. I'd build you another." And the "wait out the summer" line is interesting. I'm not sure what it means, so this is purely speculation. Summertime relationships are often stereotypically characterized with fluffy, happy feelings and possibly a lack of intent for the long term. So I don't know if waiting out the summer means a willingness to wait out the fluff to get to the reality and the struggle, because that's really what's going to bond you together if you can get through it. In theory, that fits with the song, unless culturally in New Zealand, summertime is characterized by struggle. Don't go away. In an interview I read, Liz Stokes seemed self-aware that this song could come across as demanding towards friends that have gone on to follow dreams and ambitions. So it seems to be just a bit of playful indulgence into calling out your friends who have moved away, while still rooting for them. On the surface, it was the first to remind me of Sarah and I, and the first I shared with her when she was on her way back to college. The song is boppy, yet melancholy. Mars, the god of war, is an epic battle waged over email. Indeed, this confrontation hides behind a screen and can inflict damage from over 1,000 miles. The song, which is a spiritual successor to Dying to Believe, uses choice wordplay to recall a night when vocalist Liz, with Mars visible in the sky, wrote an email responding to a friend, imagining her computer as a war machine. It also features themes of self-doubt in the midst of the battle, which results in editing out harsher sentiments. You are a beam of light. I'll start by reading verse 3. I hear you cry from the other side of a broadband line that cuts in and out 2 seconds behind. You go quiet and say goodnight. You go quiet and say goodnight. When you see a friend hurting from a distance, it hurts to not be there for them in person. Video calls with poor signals can never help emotionally like a hug can. This one really feels like a culmination of all the other long distance relationship / friendship songs. Nothing is ever wrapped up in a bow. It's often unresolved and melancholy. This song expresses feeling helpless while caring deeply for a friend or friends that give of their world to those around them, yet they struggle and can't catch a break, and yet persist, and it's inspiring, but heartbreaking. Of course, it reminds me of Sarah. Just shy of sure. When first listening to this song and being unaware of the lyrics, I thought it was happy. Upon further inspection, it's quite complicated. The vocalist equates the relationship she's in to a gamble she's optimistic about, but is just shy of being sure that her significant other loves her, or at least that said relationship will last. Focusing on making the relationship work gives her a headache, and they'll be lucky if they pull through till the end of the weekend, all while she pretends that she's wanted. It doesn't sound like the best situation, but I guess some people do like gambling. Like the song says, you can't win without injuring, but you risk a lot. And the vocalist has been hurt in the past and buried it, and considers being alone, but views the chance of something working as worth striving for. I do like this song for its wordsmithing and nuances, and the sound is quite airy and relaxing. And maybe I'm being too harsh on it. The headache could just be from the challenge of making a relationship work, or from the self-doubt. And you always need to put a little faith in your significant other's affection for you in order to foster trust. So maybe it's not necessarily a bad situation, just one that's influenced by doubt and previous hurt. The album overall, I find it very balanced musically, and it shows a progression in maturity and range from the band's previous work. Also, it was quite timely. I discovered this exactly in its height of relatability for me. So all those elements hit me around my heart buttons. And while I'm not a lyricist, I do appreciate well thought out lyrics that have deeper meaning to offer those willing to give them a chance. When you read them, even if it's easy to guess what Liz is saying, it still makes you think critically about the nuances. And finally, there's a lot of vulnerability in the album. I appreciate that, because songs in which the artist acts like they've got it all put together make me want to vomit. Anyhow, this album is good stuff. Check it out for yourself if you haven't already. And even if you have, listen to it again. You may catch a few things you missed. Alrighty, folks. See ya, and have a happy Valentine's Day.
Something there that wasn't there before.